Lover.
Pele, the fire goddess of Hawaii.
Shh.
She's been asleep for several days.
She sleeps a good sleep.
A deep sleep.
A happy sleep.
And as she sleeps, she smiles. If you listen closely, you can hear her whisper a name while she dreams.
Lohi'au.
Lohi'au.
Lohi'au ipo. The name of a man.
It must be a good dream.
A happy dream.
A dream of romance.
Pele winks.
She stirs.
And she tells her dream to her sisters.
Hi'iaka. There are many.
Hi'iaka.
Who can count them?
Hi'iaka. The sisters of Pele.
The sisters Hi'iaka.
Hi'iaka ika'ale moi.
Ai. Eo. Hi'iaka pai kau hele.
Eo. Hi'iaka ika pua ane ane.
Eo. Hi'iaka ika pua lau I.
Eo. Hi'iaka noho lai. Eo. Hi'iaka wahi lani.
Eo. Hi'iaka ale I.
Eo.
Are we all gathered?
All but you know who.
Who?
The youngest.
The prettiest.
The spoiled brat.
Of course.
Hi'iaka ika pole o Pele.
Pele's favorite.
Where is she? Gone. Pele sent her on a journey all the way to the island of Kauai.
Why? To fetch her man. While Pele slept, her spirit traveled to the island of Kauai, where she met a handsome man.
What's his name?
His name is Lohi'au, and according to Pele, he's the most handsome man in all the island.
Wow!
Pele sent her to fetch Lohi'au and bring him back here.
Well, why didn't she just ask one of us to do it?
She did, you dingbat. Weren't you paying attention?
No.
Pele asked if any of us would do it, and we all said no. The journey to Kauai is way too dangerous.
Yes, climbing all those cliffs, crossing all those rivers, going from island to island to island to island, and not to mention the mo'o.
The mo'o?
Yes, the mo'o. Dreadful creatures, those mo'o. They'll stalk you and trick you and rip your face off if you let them.
Oh, poor hi'iaka ika pole o Pele.
Oh, please. Better her than us. And besides, she's not alone. Pele ordered Pa'u'opala'a to be her traveling companion.
Pa'u'opala'a, she's weird.
She may be weird, but she's powerful. Pa'u'opala'a possesses the spirit and the force, the mana of the forest, and can summon any plant to her aid.
Wow!
And as soon as they started their journey, they were joined by another wahine, a mortal. Her name is Wahine Oma'o. And to top it all off, Pele gave Hi'iaka the pa'u.
Not the pa'u?
Yes, the pa'u.
What pa'u?
The pa'u of power. Pele imbued the skirt with her own mana, and anyone who wears the skirt will possess the power of Pele herself.
Wow!
So wait. Pa'u'opala'a to watch her back, Wahine Oma'o to keep her company, and Pele's pa'u of power around her waist for protection. The young Hi'iaka will be just fine.
Well, That depends.
Depends on what?
On whether or not Hiiaka decides to lead the three of them through his grove.
His grove?
His grove.
The grove of the ma'o.
Pana Eva watched with his ominous eyes as three figures made their way closer and closer to his forest domain. They were still quite a distance away. The three figures were far too distant for ordinary eyes to see, but Pana Eva did not have ordinary eyes, nor did he possess an ordinary body, for Pana Eva was a mo'o. Mo'o are fierce beings. They exist in both the natural and supernatural realms. They dwell in deep ponds, damp forests, wet caves. Mo'o can take the form of different plants, animals, even humans. But the true form of a mo'o is difficult to describe, for few have ever actually seen one. Most say that mo'o are dragon-like lizards with huge bodies, long tongues, and sharp claws. Others say that a mo'o's form is more water-like, constantly changing, constantly reforming itself. But whatever a mo'o looks like, there is one thing about them that is certain. Mo'o are very territorial. They will inflict great harm on whoever enters their home uninvited. And it seemed to Pana Eva that these three figures in the distance were going to do just that. So Pana Eva watched. He could make out that the three figures were wahine, female, and they were about to enter a very dangerous place, the uplands of Puna. That area was the home of Lehua'ula and Lehua'kea. These two kupua, or shapeshifters, were the descendants of Halulu, the monstrous bird of the ancient days, who would swoop down and devour men whole. From this great ancestor of theirs, Lehua'ula and Lehua'kea inherited the ability to transform from birds to humans and back again. Pana Eva watched as the three wahine paused abruptly. In front of them stood two incredibly handsome men. It was Lehua'ula and Lehua'kea. Pana Eva had seen this game many times before. The two birdmen would use their handsome human forms to entice their victims, then do with them what they will. These three wahine didn't stand a chance. One of them was instantly entranced by the cunning of the birdmen, while the other, the second, started to frolic in the plants, and the third seemed to clutch her pa'u, the skirt that she wore, like a bashful little girl. The mo'o laughed out loud. He knew what would follow. One by one, the three wahine would fall victim to the birdmen, becoming enraptured by their enchantment until it was too late. Then something unexpected happened. The two birdmen took to the sky and flew off as fast as they could. Pana Eva was confused. What could have caused the descendants of the great bird Halulu to fly off so skittishly, so shamefully? Perhaps he had underestimated these three wahine. As he peered even more intently, his eyes kept going to one in particular. It was the bashful one, the one who clutched her pa'u. Only she wasn't bashful at all, Pana Eva realized. Even from this distance, the mo'o could tell that this wahine was quite confident, something that Pana Eva did not appreciate at all. So he continued to watch. The three women continued on their breathless journey, traveling over steep hills and down treacherous slopes. They crossed dangerous rivers and faced imposing cliffs. Eventually, their path led them to a point where a decision had to be made. Do they continue on through the uplands or head seaward through Haena? Now, the obvious route would have been to go through Haena along the coast. This was the easier way, the path most would have chosen. The women, however, chose otherwise and decided to continue on through the uplands on a path that would lead them directly to Panaeva's forest. The mo'o was furious. All knew of Panaeva's land. All knew of his towering Ohialehua trees, trees covered with crimson blossoms that made Panaeva's grove a foreboding island of red. All knew to stay far from this place, yet here were these three arrogant wahine treading where no one else dared. His blood boiled. His body trembled like a raging river. How dare these wahine? These wahine. The current within settled. Wahine, he thought. He had allowed his anger to rise at the thought of three weak, trifling human women. No, not even women, he thought. Girls, they weren't even worth his time. And yet, his eyes kept going back to that confident one. There was something about her. Perhaps it was that pa'u, that skirt that she wore. Panaeva had never seen anything like it. It was peculiar, almost magical even. He froze as a sudden thought came to his mind. It was rumored that Pele, the powerful volcano goddess, had given her enchanted pa'u to her youngest sister, Hi'iakaikapolio Pele. With that pa'u, Pele could channel, Hi'iaka could channel Pele's own power directly from the volcano Kilauea. Could this confident wahine in the distance be Hi'iaka? And could that be the dreaded pa'u that she wore? Panaeva could not risk waiting to find out. For Pele and her entire family were the sworn enemies of the Mo'o clan. Immediately, he sent his minions, Kukulu Kukui and Kapua Koi'a, to find out. Kukulu! Kukulu Kukui! Ah, where is that idiot? Kukulu! Panaeva sent us to find those wahine and spy on them. We're supposed to be hiding, and you're nowhere to be found. I'm right here, Kapua. I thought hiding meant you weren't supposed to be found. Anyway, I found the three wahine, and I was spying on them. Come on, I'll show you. See, there they are. One, two, three wahine. And I'm pretty sure the one with the fancy skirt is Hi'iaka, just as Panaeva feared.
Huh? Well, let me see. Oh, yeah, well, there's three of them, and, they certainly are wahine, but, nope, that's not Hi'iaka.
Kapua? I'm pretty sure that is Hi'iaka. Something about the way the other two keep calling her Hi'iaka.
Kukulu, you're an idiot.
Of course they want us to think that she's Hi'iaka. If we think that she's Hi'iaka, then we're gonna run away in terror. And if we run away in terror, then they're gonna go to Panaeva pretending to be us. And if they go to Panaeva pretending to be us, then Panaeva is gonna think that we turned into women and we'll never eat bananas again.
Kapua, I don't think that's what would happen. Of course it's what would happen, you idiot. Now, I don't wanna hear anything more about Hi'iaka. You and I are leaving.
Okay, Kapua. If you don't think that's her, I guess we should just head back to Panaeva and tell him that everything's fine. Uh-oh, it's too late. He's already here.
What's too late? Who's already? Oh, it's Panaeva, isn't it? And he's standing right behind me, isn't he? Hi there, Panaeva. My, you're looking quite mo'oish today. Which is difficult to describe for few have ever actually seen one. The three wahine? I can assure you that none of them are the dreaded hi'iakaika polio pele like you feared. What's that sound? Well, let me listen. Well, it sounds like the voice of a wahine chanting. Uh-oh. Just then, a single chanter engulfed the entire forest with her voice. The words were directed to Panaeva, asking entrance into his land. The chanter naming herself as none other than Hi'iakaikapoli o Pele. Panaeva bellowed his response. You arrogant little girl, never will you step foot onto my land. The only entrance I'll grant you is into the realm of death. E oki oki na po'o na ulalele. E oki oki na po'o na ulalele. It was a command given to his minions Kukulu Kukui and Kapua Koi'a. A command that would surely bring about the death of Hi'iaka, but at a cost almost too ghastly to imagine. Their instructions, chop off the heads of all the leaping red wraiths, letting their preternatural blood gush forth to drown the three wahine in a river of red. The two minions did as instructed. This is disgusting. Who knew these wraiths had so much blood in them? Look at that. It keeps gushing and gushing and gushing. It's revolting. Kapua? Maybe if you listened to me, then we wouldn't be in this mess. Maybe if you told Panaeva the truth, then he would have gotten one of his other minions to chop off the heads of all these poor wraiths. Kukulu, you're an idiot. Obviously, Panaeva chose us to do it because we're the best head choppers around. I bet he's even planning on giving us a promotion. Oh, I get it. So Panaeva is giving us a chance to get ahead. Kukulu, you're an idiot. On and on the minions chopped, and the blood of the wraiths quickly rose and flooded the forest. But Hi'iaka and her two companions simply stood there, holding tight to that enchanted pa'u of hers. More and more blood flowed, reaching their chins, threatening to drown them, but still they clutched that pa'u. Then what came next seemed to happen all at once. In an instant, the sky turned black with smoke. Pele's smoke. Hi'iaka had channeled the power of her sister Pele. Then Hi'iaka's voice was heard throughout the forest in a chant, calling out to the denizens of the Lewalani, asking those gods from above to release their drenching rains, which they did. Those Akua of the Lewalani let loose torrents of water that washed away all of the blood that covered them and carried Panaeva and his minions out to sea.
Kukulu! Kukulu, you idiot, get over here and help me paddle this log back to shore. No, I will not help you, Kapua. This is all your fault. If you had just listened to me, we wouldn't be in this mess. So you can just paddle your own log. I'm leaving. Oh, and one more thing, Kapua. You're the idiot.
So,
Hi'iaka
and her companions continued on their journey. And as for Panaeva, it said that his body was eaten by a giant fish, but his huge grove of red-blossomed Ohi'alehua trees continued to stand, and that area will forever be known as Panaeva Nui Mokulehua, the great forest island of the Mo'o Panaeva.
Aina na nika ulana, na kua hivye kolu, mokupumi nui oke ave, e Hawaii. Kaulana oi kalehua pua ulana ni mua olela, maelea ohana eva.
After the grove of Panaeva, Hi'iaka and her companions continued to face trial after trial.
In Waiakea, they encountered a whole horde of mo'o.
In Waialama, they were attacked by wicked spirits.
In the great Wailuku River was guarded by two more mo'o.
But none of them were any match for the power of the pa'u.
On and on they journeyed until they reached the ocean and boarded a canoe.
And set off to the island of Maui.
Ohea ohe Maui, kila kila alea kala, ua kuhu ho'okahi ohe, mea nani mua olela. Maui, o Maui no e ka ohi, kaulana rosela ni pua kalana nila, na ho'okahi waleno.
Upon landing, the three were greeted by the beauty of Maui.
In Wailua Iki, they feasted with Ohana.
Then, in Ka'akuloa, they witnessed the crippled phantom chanting to a shark.
From there, they traveled to Molokai before voyaging off to the next island.
The island of Oahu.
Auhea oe Oahu, aina ku kalahale. Honolulu ke kapitela, jiko aina o ke kauna. O ahu, ohu ohu oe ka ilima, ulu mele mele o ke kuahiri, nania noe o ahu.
O ahu was an island of excitement,
the weeping akua,
the mo'o of Kauai Nui,
the ancient stone dog,
a wrathful goddess.
Then, in Mokule'ia, they were visited by the spirit of Lohi'au.
Pele's love.
The man they sought to bring back.
His spirit told him that his body had died.
So they traveled to the island of Kauai.
Auhea oe Kauai, kaulana I ka mokihana, uaia e kehala.
Finally, the three reached Kauai, the home of Lohi'au.
And with sadness, they entered into the village that he lived.
My name is Pau'oa, and I was there, you know, seated at my pahu, beating out the rhythms on that drum. to accompany my prince, our chief, and my best friend, Lohiau, as he danced the hula. His body glistened in the moonlight as each bead of perspiration clung to his nakedness. His motions told the story of Kaulilua ike anu vai ale ale, the haughty and cold vai ale ale, our sacred mountain of Kauai. All in attendance were mesmerized, the women secretly matching his ami and uwehe with those of his own, their own. The men envying, admiring the fullness of his manhood. I was lost in the drumming, so I did not hear the murmuring through the crowd until it got louder, and finally, the crowd dispersed, leaving the sight of the most beautiful woman in their wake. She glanced past the drummers and was transfixed upon our chief. Lohiau froze mid-hula and was unable to speak. So it was she who spoke first.
Kau mai ka noe o alakai, I ka ele ua o manua ke pā, u oi kui ka loa o ko I alana, I ka alakai a a ka malihini e, maina, maina au, mai pālahaya oe, I mi valena au o kahi o ke ola, o ke ola nei e, 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 e.
My quest was for comfort and life, just comfort and life, she said. Lohiau roused from his ecstasy and rose to the occasion and invited the stranger to partake of the feast. Inquiries as to where she was from and who she was were brushed aside until later that evening, when she could no longer resist his entreaties and answered, I am from Puna, the land of the sunrise, from Haʻehaʻe, the eastern gate of the sun. It was then that I knew she could be none other then Pele, the goddess of the fire. Lohiau will invite her to stay the night. However, the night is spent in embraces and kisses, nothing more. This will happen for 3 nights, and my chief, who is used to having his way, is frustrated. Pele then will explain that she had to leave to return to Kilauea, but that she would prepare a home for him. When the time was right, she would send an emissary to fetch him. If a man comes, he is not to follow. Only come if it is a woman. She then leaves. Lohiau can't believe what has just happened. He is distraught. Was it all a dream? His desire for this woman had consumed his body and weakened his mind. It's delirious. We were worried. We had not seen our chief for several days, and upon entering the hale, we were aghast at the sight of Lohiau's lifeless body. Away! Away! My chief, my prince, my grief soon turned to anger, and I tore the mala from my loins and vowed to seek vengeance on the woman who did this to my chief, hunting her down and defiling her body with all manner of indignities, even if she were the goddess Pele. However, the injury to Lohiau does not end with his death. As he lay in state, his body is stolen by two women. He is so handsome that women coveted him dead or alive. But these were no ordinary women. They were mo'o. They hid Lohiau's body in a cave high up on the cliffs. And, intending to use their supernatural powers, bring him back to life so that they could have him for themselves. But as promised, Pele will send her younger sister, Hi'iaka, to fetch her betrothed. She is accompanied by Wahine Oma'o and Pa'u'o Pala'a. When they learn that Lohiau died and that his body was snatched by two mo'o women, these emissaries of Pele girded their loins for battle, for they are mortal enemies of the water dwellers and vice versa. Ooh, you should have seen the catfight that took place between these fierce wahine. As soon as Hi'iaka and her companions started to climb the cliff, the mo'o women hurled huge boulders down at them. But these boulders were no match for the pa'u around Hi'iaka's waist. So the mo'o women hid. And when Hi'iaka and her companions climbed the cliff, the mo'o women reappeared as terrifying monsters. One clawed at the neck of Hi'iaka, while the other grabbed for her pa'u, the power of her source. Hi'iaka was about to be overwhelmed by the strength of these mo'o women, when suddenly, vines, roots, branches, leaves grew around the mo'o. It was pa'u pala'a. She had summoned the spirits of the forest to their aid. The iwa-iwa, the mo'o pala'a, all the trees grew around the mo'o, covering them from head to toe, allowing Hi'iaka to break free. Hi'iaka punched one of the women in the gut, pow, and he kneed one in the back, bam. She picked them up and threw them down on the hard rock, sending them hurtling down the cliff that she and her companions had just crawled up. But the fierce mo'o leapt back up the cliff, but were stopped once again by the creatures of the forest. Lohia and Hi'iaka called upon all the forces of her enchanted pa'u and incinerated the two mo'o, leaving heaps of ash in their stead, thus ending the battle. When the smoke cleared, they heard a faint voice. Spirit calling out to Pele to save him. They followed the voice of the cave and retrieved his hidden body. Using prayers and incantations, they brought Lohiau back to life. I was summoned from the island of Ni'ihau with the news that Lohiau lived. Tears of joy streamed down my face at the news, at the thought of being reunited with my prince. However, my joy is short-lived. Upon reaching the island of Kauai, Lohiau, Hi'iaka, and her companions were making haste to the island of Hawaii, where Pele awaited. I begged him to take me with him. However, Lohiau admonished me, saying that my kuleana was to remain on Kauai and take charge in his absence. I wish I had insisted, for I saw the look in his eyes when he gazed at Hi'iaka. The girl was innocent and faithful to her sister. But I knew it was just a matter of time. I wish.
Having brought Lohiau back to life, Hi'iaka and her companions began the journey back to Kilauea.
But Pele was not happy, for she thought, for if Hi'iaka had taken too long to return.
Hi'iaka, Pele was jealous.
Pele thought that Hiiaka had betrayed her and had taken the handsome Lohiau as her own, so Pele sought revenge. Kilauea, the volcano in which she dwelled, began to rumble and hiss.
And it murmured and roared.
Then with anger and fury, Pele loosed her fiery lava high into the sky.
Hiiaka stood far away on the island of Oahu.
But even from that distance, she knew. She sensed Pele's intent.
And she feared. She feared for her friend.
Her aikane.
Her sweet one, Hopoi.
Hopoi, who dances beneath the lehua blossoms.
Hopoi, who awaits the return of her dear one.
Hopoi, the innocent beauty that sits alone in the grove. Hopoi, kalehua ki'e ki'e iluna.
Aiala o pele I Hawaii e ke a mai lai mau ke lea uhi uha mai ana e ke no mea e lai a puna e The beauty of Pele. Her lava dances in dazzling fountains against the evening sky, then cascades down the mountain in a brilliant yellow and glowing orange. Its journey is steady to the sea, where it will dance one final dance with the waves, and then it will rest. The beauty of Pele. As her lava flows, the land will increase. But as Pele adds to the land, so too does she take from it. Her hunger is ravenous. She feeds on everything that lays in her path. And now she hungers for my grove. Soon all of my beautiful trees full of lehua blossoms will be gone, and I with them. Pele's lava draws near.
Uhi, uaha.
It speaks as it feeds.
Uhi, uaha.
It is the voice of the land.
Uhi, uaha.
A beautiful sound, whispering to me, reminding me not to be fearful. Every blossom of lehua will bloom, and then it will fall, lending its mana, its life force to the land, helping it to grow and create something new. It is a balance, and it is perfect. But in this moment of tranquility, I am overcome with sadness. Not for my own life that will soon end, but for my friend, my dear Aikane Hiiaka. She sees the smoke that rises around me, and she weeps, desperately longing to be with me. She is angry, angry at her sister Pele for bringing her lavas to take me, and angry at herself for leaving me. Dear Hiiaka, my truest friend, do not weep, for not even the hot wrath of Pele can reign supreme. Her lavas will be stopped by the elder sister Namakaokahai, who rules the waves and the sea. Her fires will be quenched by Wakea, our father, who sends his cooling rains. And in that time, the footsteps of the youngest will cover each bed of lava with lush valleys and rich forests. The youngest, you, Hiiaka, your purity will cause my lehua trees to grow anew. And in that time, you and I will meet again.
Uhi, uaha.
Hiiaka, I see you.
Uhi, ua.
Hiiaka, I know you.
Uhi, ua.
Hiiaka, my beautiful aikane. Aloha wawia oi. Love, love, love.
Akaluna opu ni oni ke anaina kawaine. Ki eikeia uluia waine kapu no ana papala uai. Laua hi pele I kai o puna, o ne a kai o malama. Malama I ke kanaka, a he puala ole. Ina mai ka inoa, kua ka puo iaka. He inoa no hi iaka I ka poli o Pele.
Hi iaka I ka le moi.
E oho. Oh, hia ka pai kau hele.
E o, hia kai ka pua ane ane.
E o, hia kai ka pua lau I.
E o, hia ka noho lai.
E o, hia ka wā I lani.
E o, hia ka ale I.
E o.
Oh, are we all gathered?
Aye, gathered. And waiting for the wrath of our youngest.
The prettiest.
And the powerful.
Hia kai ka poli o Pele.
Oh, she's angry.
Angry at who?
Angry at Pele.
And she's destroying the foundation of our home.
Our home?
The volcano Kilauea.
Oh, no!
She leaped into the crater and started to demolish the groundwork in her rage.
She's been crushing layer after layer of the upholding rock, weakening it, making it vulnerable.
And now we have no defense against our uncle's water.
Our uncle? Kanemilo High, he who controls the flowing water.
Hiaka has his favor.
And if someone doesn't stop her, she'll bring those waters and destroy us all.
Well, maybe if we just ask really nicely, then she'll stop. Excuse me, Hiaka. Hiaka I ka poli o Pele. Could you please not kill us all in your cruel, tyrannical rage, pretty, pretty, please?
Oh, be quiet, you dingbat. She'll never listen to us. The only one she'll listen to is Pele.
Pele must go and apologize to her for killing her friend Hopoi. It's the only way to save us all.
Well, she better hurry, because I can hear the waters coming.
Oh, Pele! Pele, come help us now! This is all your fault!
I am so sorry.
Wait, what's that sound?
It's Pele. She's emerging from her cave to face Hiiaka.
What will she say? Hui!
Hiiaka I ka poli o Pele!
You dare to threaten me with destruction! You dare to bring the waters of our great uncle! You dare to douse my fires in your rage! I, Pele! I, the woman of the pit who consumes the land! I, who carried your embryonic form from the land of Kahiki! My sister, my favorite, youngest of our clan, your wrath is just. I have wronged you, my dear one. I have allowed my jealousy to cloud my mind, and have struck you where it hurts the most.
Hopoi was innocent, and I have taken her from you.
Forgive me, my sister.
Remember my love.
And remember my sheltering walls that will always be your home. The lives of us all are in your hands. Forgiveness is what I ask.
My dear.
My sweet.
Hi'iaka ika poli o pele.
And so, Hi'iaka's rage settled.
Her love for her oldest sister Pele returned, for she understood how the love of a man could drive a person mad.
Especially the handsome Lohiau.
Lohiau. Lohiau ipo.
What became of him?
He returned to the island of Kauai, and he was still in love.
With Pele?
And Hi'iaka.
Well, who did he choose?
Who can say?
He loved them both, and they both loved him.
And now it's time.
Time for those words.
Time for the words that end all tales.
The words that have kept our stories alive from last generation to this one and will until the next.
Pipi holo ka'au.
Let the sprinkled tales travel far.
Aiala o pele I Hawaiia, mea ama ila I mau kelea, ui ua mai ana ea, ke la mea ane ai a kuna ea, o a kae kalani moke moke, e pele e pele, e pele e pele, e pele.
Mahalo, everyone.
Mahalo.
Mahalo, all of you, for joining us today. We're visiting from the islands of Hawaii. My name is Moses.
I'm Anakala Kealoha.
And I'm Lelea'e.
And we share our stories of our kupuna, the stories of our ancestors. And we want all of you to have a wonderful day. Aloha.
Aloha. Mahalo.